Turn to 2 Timothy this evening, chapter 1. Anybody here tonight for the first time, men's study? See your hand out there. Anybody? Come on. All right, guys. Didn't see enough hands, so you need to speak to Pastor Tuvai in the back, and he'll let you know what your assignment is. Now, let's be inviting guys to come on out, enjoying what God is doing. I take it you guys liked the message last week. Amen? Oh, yeah. It was incredible. And just so you know, you might have known this, maybe not, I talked about it. I think Levi has written this book, Through the Eyes of a Lion, and this is really the outgrowth of the passing of his five-year-old daughter that he touched lightly on during that message. But this is the story of it, and we'll probably refer to this a little bit tonight in our message, which is entitled, Suffer Accordingly. Now remember, we were in chapter 1, and the whole chapter really has to do with Paul's encouragement to his dear beloved son in the faith, Timothy, who's going through it. He's got this, imagine, you know, as I shared before, he gets this letter in his hand, and he's reading through the thing, and he gets to the last part here. I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. And of course, he's telling Timothy, he's telling the world, of course, that he knows that his time is short. And Tim needs encouragement. I remember we started, you know, last 2 weeks ago, we were talking about stir it up. And verse 6 says, therefore, I remind you to stir it up, to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. And this whole passage here really speaks of this the idea, the reality, the truth of suffering as Christians, as men of God trying to follow after. And you know, to be honest with you, this whole deal of suffering, and this is what this whole message is tonight. And of course, we got some points we want to cover, but man, what is up with that? How do we reconcile the sufferings that we go through as Christian men? And looking at this, and you know, what do you say to somebody who's going through? What could anybody have said to Levi while he was going through the midst of that? Even as a pastor, for as long as he's known the Lord, all that was going on. And yet God ordained and allowed and really, in a sense, brought this to him. This area, this idea of suffering. And he's telling Tim, really, you got to accept it, Tim. Don't be ashamed of it. Not like what we think that means, guilt-ridden and innocent. No, don't try and hide it. Don't try and get away from it, in a sense. Don't be ashamed of it. Don't be ashamed of these sufferings. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of me. Don't try and hide the fact that you know me, you know Jesus. And, of course, you're looking at the situation where, you know, Paul is going to die for what? Because he's a Christian. People associated with anybody who knew Paul, I'm sure, being chased down and hunted and sought after, and you know, you're a part of this, and Timothy was a big part of it. Don't be ashamed of it, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. And what is this? What is it with that? Why do we have to go through the stuff we go through? And honestly, if there's any one thing that I've seen in Christianity that causes people to run out the door, throw in the towel, and turn their back on Jesus, is the sufferings that come, especially in light of the fact that we've come to the Lord, we're doing the best we can, we're trying the best we can to follow, and yet still, your world falls apart. Anybody say amen to that? Anybody just like, really? This is what I get? This is, you know? And so this whole idea, suffering, it's like, it's God's boot camp. Really. It's God's boot camp. And that's what suffering is about. Now you think about it. Those of you that were in the service, those of you particularly, maybe we use Marines, because everybody's like, oh, you're all Marines and everything. This whole idea of, could you imagine going into the Marines without boot camp? What would the Marines be like? I mean, yeah, Girl Scouts. The whole marine thing is the fact that if you can be man enough, in a sense, to make it through this boot camp and to call yourself a marine, because that's, you're not calling yourself a marine until you do what? Till you graduate, you make it through boot camp. Imagine if they did away with that. The same goes with God. Imagine if there was no sufferings. It would be heaven. And we would jump over this whole experience of learning how to cling to Jesus like never before in your life. Christianity wouldn't even be Christianity if there wasn't the sufferings. Because the example that Jesus set in that, and it's amazing that you read there in Hebrews where it says he learned obedience through the things he suffered. What? Jesus didn't need to learn anything. Oh yeah, he did. For our example, for us to be able to relate, for us to see that he was this high priest who knew what we were going through, guys. I mean, you can't relate to anybody. And you real Marines out there, you guys that went through it all, I could walk up to you and say, oh yeah, man, yeah, service is tough, man, yeah, you know. So how long were you in the Marines for? I never was in the service. There's no relationship there. I have no idea what you guys went through. People went through Vietnam. Non-Vietnam people, we have no clue what they experienced over there. And yet you, and then you, two Vietnam vets, you're bonded for life. You have a relationship that surpasses any, you know, and you know what I'm talking about. Even in the sports, even you guys, remember going through the sports experiences that those of you, and probably 75% of you, you know, with some sort of sports where you had, you know, we'll just use football. Remember Hell Week? Remember Two-A-Days? Remember you thought, this is just plain stupid. I'm going to die out here. Mama, come and get me. You know, you're just a high school punk kid. And yet, I can still remember years ago, it wasn't Hell Week, but playing soccer at Torrance High, we'd played South, and we played so horribly. It was just like a joke, and the coach was so mad at us that he took us out Saturday morning over there at Torrance High at the stadium, Zamperini Stadium, and literally took us within an inch of our lives. I kid you not. 120 bleachers, we remember. Crab crawls back and forth. People, guys puking, guys coming out the back. I mean, it was nuts. It was literally nuts. I mean, nowadays, they'd have locked the coach up. He'd have been arrested right then and there in the spot. And yet, we still talk about that. Guys that I know that went through that experience together. And yet, when you look back, you go, I was like, that was bad. That was awesome, man. That was like so cool. That was like, you know? And yet the same experience happens when we go through these things called suffering. He tells Timothy, accept it as Jesus did and accept it as I have. And Paul talks very much in this whole book about the sufferings. Look at chapter 2. Therefore, you must endure hardship as a good soldier. Verse 9, for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer to the point of chains. Chapter 3, verse 12. He's saying, yes, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And he's referring to, in verse 11, he didn't forget about what happened in Acts 14. What happened there in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. That's the place, remember what happened there? They stoned Paul, left him for dead. And quite, he might have been dead. And yet that crazy guy pops up. And he goes and he tells the disciples, we must, with what? Much tribulations, enter the kingdom of God. We ain't getting around it. We're not going to get through it. Here's a little quote from this book, and I've quoted this before, Crowded to Christ, Ellie Maxwell. And all the pastors, some guys in leadership, we've read this book, and it's just killer. But here it is. Here's what it is all about when it comes to trials and sufferings as a Christian man or woman. Can many persons keep themselves in a perpetual foment through hoping they will get into a situation where they can enjoy a better Christian life? Anybody say amen to that? Man, blue skies, green lights, Starbucks and In-N-Outs. Nothing better now. I'm good. I'm happy. They feel enclosed in a net of circumstances which they cannot accept. They are so wearied and baffled and beaten by the continuous pressure about them that they wish and itch for things to be different, quite sure that if things were only different, Christ would be more real. It has never dawned upon them that at the heart of these very circumstances, they are to find Christ, find His grace sufficient, find the life more abundant. So why the perpetual perils, the hot pursuits, the unrelenting pressure? Why the long, unending succession? Is it mere incident and accident? No. The purpose is that the life of Jesus might be made manifest. Unless Paul be in peril, how can he experience God's escape? Unless exposed to danger and death, how can he enjoy God's deliverance? Unless he be pressed out of measure, how can he appreciate relief? Unless battered down, how can he be lifted up in the life all divine? In spite of care and prayer, do things go wrong day after day in never-ending succession? Anybody relating to this? Are you desperately holding out against the process, praying that the thorn may be removed, only to be crowned with more? Worst of all, you know that you can neither manage nor control the forces arrayed against you. And this is where the guy's nuts. Why then not just settle down and settle in? Accept the fact that this is your lot for life, and neither accidental nor incidental. Cease hoping for things to be otherwise, and cease itching to be otherwhere. For you're not moving on, not moving out. This is life. This is home. You may just as well unpack in your weariest and weakest and most bewildered moment, simply say, "Now, Lord, here is my chance and thine, my chance to die and thy chance to manifest the life of Jesus." Our mortal life is full of testings, testings in home, in business, in public life, in ministerial life, that we may not think them strange. God in His great mercy has given us in the Scriptures detailed experiences of certain characters whose spiritual history is much like our own. Kind of callous in a sense. You might as well just unpack. You're home, baby. This is it. It's almost like in the movie Pirates of the Caribbean where the crazy captain, you know what I'm talking about. Not Sparrow, the other guy. You think this is a nightmare? Well, you're in one kind of a thing. This is it. This is life, guys. This is life. This is the experience that God allows for us. And there's no way to get through it except to go through it. And it's like perpetual boot camp, but a boot camp that never ends, but you continually get in better shape. Follow me? Because as you go through life's experiences, as you experience heartbreaking situations, Levi's heartbreaking situation. You know, guys, he's a 32-year-old kid teaching at the senior pastor's conference where they have nobody up on that stage except for these men who make this whole thing happen. Look and see. I guarantee you that 32-year-old kid would not have been up on that stage had he not experienced what he went through. And not that that was some sort of a reward, but it was viewed and people saw his response and his reaction and how he clung to Christ and how God has used it in his life and God is continuing to use it in life. It's not over. It's not over. And there's this continuous experience of going through life. And even as Paul said there in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, "Therefore I most rather boast in my infirmities that the power of God may rest in me. I take pleasure in reproaches and needs and distress." I mean, all these things. You look at that and go, "Paul, you're crazy. I take pleasure?" He had got to the point, guys, where it finally clicked. Not that he was some sort of like masochist or something like, you know, yeah, just beat me down, man. This is going to be great because I know, you know, something's going to happen good for it. So go ahead. I mean, there's people that are crazy that way.
You know,
asceticism kind of a thing, you know, aha, you know, I'll wear camel skins for a year and a half and I'll only eat, you know, one meal a week, you know, because I know, it, you know, I'm going to get closer to God through it. That's weird. But what Paul was saying was he finally figured it out. That this experience in life that God brings our way, men. And I've been doing this men's study for quite a bit of time. And I'm telling you, every single year, we go through stuff. I've gone through stuff. And it's just, it's almost to the point where maybe someone else could do the men's study. And I just hang out and just, you know. And it's not just me. It's you. It's everybody in Christianity. God ordains it. And so he says here, first off, number one, accept your suffering, verse 8, therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. And this ashamed means to want to hide something, to want others not to know. And, you know, it's interesting. You read through, you know, because me personally, when someone says, you know, be ashamed of something, I have a really negative connotation. And I don't see that in the wording in the language here. It's not the same thing that I thought. You know, maybe, you know, when you're ashamed of something, I mean, you're like guilty and shameful. You don't want nobody to know, you know, and you're going to, you know, what he's talking about is that word, but in the sense of, Tim, don't hide the fact that you know Jesus. Don't run from the fact that you know me. I understand why you would want, but whatever you're going to experience in making it known that you're still who you are, no matter what's going on in my life, no matter what's happening with Christianity today, and guys, that's a tough call for us because we see, in a sense, Christianity kind of on the run, huh? You know, and it's like, wait a minute, you know, the mockings, the ridicule, the embarrassment that you might have experienced in your workplace. Oh, you know, there's Paul there, you know, the Christian dude, you know, thinks he's all, you know, how idiotic is his belief and everything? Can you believe that? I mean, with science the way it is, and he works in places where those people are kind of smart, and that kind of stuff comes. And it's tough sometimes. You look at it kind of in a sense, it's like, you know, we see what's taking place with Christians around the world and the persecutions and the ISIS and that whole deal and just the radical way that the world has turned against Christianity. Guarantee if that was happening to Islam, oh, the whole world would come to, oh my gosh, we've got to jump in and help those. Or if it was homosexuals that was happening to, oh, we've got to come and help, oh, we've got to, you know, Christians, you deserve it. In the back of their minds. Really? We could get that way. Don't be ashamed about what? The testimony of our Lord. Remember, we talked about this, the cross. See, we have a different view of the cross. It's glorious. Man, at the foot of the cross, I mean, wow, we love the cross. Back then, it wasn't good. It was bad, shameful. Horrible. Wait a minute. So you serve this, like, this dude that got crucified? That's who you're associated with? That? Imagine the most shameful way a person could die nowadays in your mind. And you want to be associated with that? Or, remember, the guy that's like the main leader of this whole sect, this whole movement, the way, where's he? He's a jailbird. What kind of bird don't sing? I mean, you see this whole picture here. And then you have this idea that, wait a minute, the whole thing's falling apart. It's over with. We're losing this thing. We're losing this battle. Paul's about ready to die. Where's Jesus in all this? And the devil's right there doing what? Wham! Hammering. But he says, This is all part of the plan. No mistake. No mistake. Isaiah 53. Great chapter to go and read, you guys. In this, though, one of the verses says, "And it pleased him," God, "to bruise him," Jesus, "for our iniquities." It was planned. It's all part of God's plan. It was all part of God's plan for Paul. Remember in Acts chapter 9, what the Holy Spirit tells Ananias, "You're going to go pray for this guy, Paul." Jesus is telling Ananias this. Ananias, like, "Are you sure? Are you out of your mind? I'm going to Paul." "No, no, you're going to go, and I'm going to change his life. I'm going to remove the scales, and I'm going to tell him what he must suffer for my name's sake." From the very get-go, from the slam down there in the Damascus Road, boom. "Now, this is what I'm calling you for. You're going to suffer, Paul." And suffer Paul did. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. You read through that lately? What happened to Paul? Five times beaten with the stripes. 39. Bam. Five times. Three times beaten with rods. One time stoned. He remembers that stone. He died. Pretty much a lot of people believe he died. Maybe that's even where he was taken up into heaven. You know, the whole there in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 stuff. A day and a half in the deep, suffered. So, under accept your sufferings, really number one, suffering, guys, is universal. Universal. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 9, and I can see this study is going to go long tonight, brothers. I'm not getting anywhere fast here, but this stuff is important. It is so important that we grasp this in our minds, guys. Because you're going to go through things in life that the enemy wants to take and blow you completely out of the water. But God wants to take and change a world through you for. There's a lot of people reading this very brand new book. The leadership is reading this book. It's rocking us, dudes. We were in tears today talking about chapter 3, the Christmas from hell, because his daughter died 5 days before Christmas. Woo! That ain't fair. That ain't right. Who says? Chapter 5, 1 Peter, verse 8, tying in with spiritual warfare. "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith." Here it is, guys. "Knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world." See, what you're going through is what he is going through, is what she's going through, is what I'm going through. Circumstances all varying, personal and such. We're all going through it. It's universal. 2 Timothy, of course, I revert to this. Verse 12, chapter 3. "Yes, all who desire to live godly." All. A-L-L. Not some of you, not maybe a couple of you, a few. "All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will do what? Will suffer persecution. Will suffer for your faith." It's universal. Second, suffering is normal. 1 Peter 4. And you guys, these are the scriptures you got to have memorized and underlined. It's already gone from my Bible. It's not even there anymore because I've underlined it so many times and cried over it. 1 Peter 4:12, "Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you." Isn't it amazing when you're going through it? You think you're completely isolated and you're living in this little world and it's like, nobody knows what I'm going through. Man, this is crazy. I'm going crazy. Am I going crazy? You ever thought that? When you're going through this stuff and the spiritual warfare is so heavy, you don't know what's up or what's down or what's going on. Your head's being spun around. Satan is all over you. You can't sleep. You're waking up. You're tossing and turning. Your wife's going, what's the matter with you? Go to sleep. I can't. Why? I don't know. What's happening? Satan's attacking me. I've got all these crazy thoughts going on in my head. I think I saw a hand there. Yes. As so some strange thing. But rejoice. I'd slap you upside the head. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. You've gone through it. You stayed close. You've hung with Jesus. And you're there. You made it. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and God rest upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. But here's a little caveat here. Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. In other words, don't be suffering because of your own stupidity. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be what? Ashamed. There it is. But let him glorify God in this matter. Wow. For the time has come, guys. We are living in that time, I believe, for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Man, now if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God. Anybody catch that? According to the will of God. According to the will of God. What are you saying? What are you saying? Holy cow. That's crazy stuff. According to the will of God, commit their souls to him in doing good as to a faithful creator. Suffering is normal, but also suffering is fellowship. Philippians chapter 3, turn 6 pages to the left. You know, I like to tell you 6 pages to the left kind of a thing. Because it just the proximity of all this stuff is so rich and so close in God's word. Chapter 3, Paul's big declaration, his testimony really of his life before Christ and who he was and how, man, I'm the dude. I'm a Pharisee of Pharisees. Man, confident in the flesh. Oh, stock of Israel, tribe of Benjamin, Hebrew of Hebrews, concerning the Pharisee, concerning zeal, the law, man. But verse 7, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet, indeed, I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have, what? Suffered the loss of A-L-L. What was he talking about there? All things? I honestly believe that Paul not only lost his standing, his reputation, his position, his power, his prestige, his financial gain, being a Pharisee, all this stuff. I honestly believe he lost his wife as well. Because my understanding of the culture at that time was in order to be Pharisee, you had to be married. Now, nobody knows for sure, but I got a feeling, and I've shared this before. I think she's like, wait a minute here. Wait. What are you saying, this Jesus stuff? Oh, and we got to do what now? I got to give up my, and just the things of this earth. Think about what might happen today. I got to give up my house on the hill. I got to give up my Mercedes Benz. I got to give up my Rolex watch. I got to give up my Prada purse. I mean, on and on and on. For this Jesus guy? See ya. I believe that's what happened. Suffered the loss of all things and count them rubbish that I may gain Christ. And being found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may what? I may know him. And the power of his resurrection. That's what we're talking about. Timothy, man, share with me in these things. Share with this. Don't be ashamed of this. According to what? Going back to our passage here. According to the power of God. Going back here. that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. The fellowship, guys. The fellowship. I'm telling you what, you will never be as close to Jesus as in when you are in the deepest, darkest valley of your entire life. And brothers, I can say from experience, I've lost loved ones. I've lost all you name it, mother, mother-in-law, dad, whatever. But this last experience that we all went through together as a church, that I went through personally in the loss of Pastor Steve and that whole experience going through, I'm telling you what, dudes. It kind of like pushed me over the edge of looking back and seeing the reality and the truth of Scripture like never before in my life. And if somebody told me this is what you're going to experience, this is what's going to happen, man, I'd have been through the door and on the other side of the world as fast as I could have been. And yet, looking back, oh my gosh, it's real. It really is real. The fellowship of sufferings. Finding myself in a place never, ever, ever thought that I'd experience. Never in a million years. And yet to see the faithfulness of God, to see his hand in this whole situation, to see how he carried me personally through that situation. And only God and I know what I was going through, and yet he was there, faithful. And only God knows what you're going through in that particular situation. Only God knew what Levi was going through. Only God knew what Greg Laurie was going through and the loss of Chris. Radical stuff. And yet God, man, the fellowship, guys. Suffering's universal. It's normal, but it's fellowship. And God's power will see you through it. According to the power, this Holy Spirit power we talked about 2 weeks ago, the dunamis power from God that is able to, what does it say? For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but what? Of power. And what Paul talked about to the Philippians chapter 3, it's resurrection power. That raises people from the dead. That the power over sin and death. This power that says that we'll never die. The power of God who raised him. Man, Timothy, accept your sufferings. It's okay. You're crazy, Paul. No. You must therefore endure hardship as a good soldier. Secondly, though, in this encouragement to Timothy, he says, now remember your calling, Tim. Remember the whole idea, stirring up the gift. Verse 9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Oh my gosh, are you kidding me? I mean, God, you knew all this and you've seen all this. This calling, this experience in life. And he reminds him, Tim, it was God who did it. God who did that, especially in Paul's situation. But in Timothy's as well. Here's a Greek kid running around. He doesn't know God. He's a Gentile. He's a dog, according to Jews. God saves him. God saves Paul. Radical transformation. According to God's power and his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Oh my gosh. It was God who preordained the whole thing. An amazing thing is that God is completely outside of time. He doesn't need time. He's put time and place for us in a sense, this human condition that we're in. But when we step out of time into eternity, what is time? Kind of mind-blowing. It really is. And you think of Jeremiah chapter 1. I love it. The calling on Jeremiah's life. Now, you guys are reading through the Bible along with what the church is reading through. You're in Jeremiah right now, right? But what does it say here? Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. How can that be? Isn't this amazing to think? And yet we believe that by faith, that God even has ordained and seen each and every one of us here tonight. He's outside, just checking it all out. And the little clock is ticking. God just You know, he rewinds the clock. It's crazy. Remember your calling, though, Tim. It was God. It was God who preordained you and me to encourage him in this. But then also, thirdly, remember he's alive. Verse 10b. Verse 10, but now has been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And this whole testimony of the Lord, is Jesus really alive? Now, Paul definitely knows this because Paul had seen the Lord. That's why Paul could call himself an apostle. Apostle, in the truest sense, could only be those who actually had seen Jesus. Wait a minute. Jesus was dead long before Paul was involved in this kind of deal as a Christian. No. He's seen. He's alive. But he says this word, abolish death. I love this. Renders it useless or idle. It's abolished. It's like, what's death? Oh, grave, where's your victory? Oh, death, where's your sting? Ain't no big deal. Death, what? Life? I hold the keys. It's me now. He abolished it in the eternal sense. Of course, we're still going to die unless all of a sudden, you know, we got the old Star Trek transporter room deal called the rapture. You know, we're all going to still die, but it isn't what we think. It's sleep. It's just, you know, you're going to go to sleep tonight. That's what death's like. I was doing a little graveside thing Friday, and that's what I share with the people. When you think about sleep, I mean, most of us, we love sleep, don't we? Isn't it one of the most greatest gifts of God? And every time you're going through those periods of maybe a little bit of insomnia, you just realize, oh, man, I really feel bad for people who are insomniacs, but man, for the most part, most of us, man, it's like your wife knows that you're sleeping real well, huh? She's like, stop it, you're snoring too loud. Wait a minute, look at me, I don't snore. You just love it. And that's what the idea is, though. It's like, ah. And to think about dying as that, I'm resting, but only to awaken in his likeness, in his presence. Holy smokes, it's like waking up and you know, the night before as a kid, you're going to sleep and it's Christmas and you can't wait for the presents and you go to sleep and it's like you, boom, lights are on, mom's waking you up. Wow! You dive, knock the tree over and get you whipped all at the same time at Christmas time. Remember, he's alive. He abolished death and those in Christ will never die. Spiritually life, Tim. And that's the gospel that we preach. Immortality to light. It's been revealed. Remember your calling, Tim. Remember he's alive. And then Paul really explains, this is my duty in suffering. And he doesn't say, Tim, this is what you're to do. This is me. But Paul, of course, said so many times, now, follow my example. To which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles. For this reason, I also suffer. This reason, this is what, in this appointment here, ordained or commissioned by who? Who did that? Remember, in Paul's testimony, did Paul sign up for that? Did Paul go down to the recruiting station? Hey, man, I'm going to sign up for this Christian thing. I'm all on board this. I'm excited about this. Yeah. No. He had no choice. Oh, he had a choice. But I'm telling you what, I think God still would have smacked him down a couple more times. Had he not said, okay, Lord, this is real. He was appointed to this. No shame, Tim. No shame. This is my duty in suffering. To be this preacher, to be this herald, this proclaimer, to this apostle, and really speaking of the authority even as an ambassador. And this teacher, this instructor or interpreter of God's word to share with the people. And really what he was saying, Tim, I'm appointed. I'm in God's perfect will. Wait a minute. In any day now, you're going to lose your head. You're God's perfect will. Do you think Levi was in God's perfect will? That's part of, that really just blows me away. John the Baptist, Jesus, we got to talk. We got to talk about this John the Baptist deal. Really? You could have had him die any other way. But you had to put his head on a platter to be, think about that. They probably fell off the platter. Oops, sorry about that. Hey, wait a minute. We just invented soccer. Sick thought, but that's the disrespect that was given to this man. Cut his head off. Really? Pointed. I'm in God's perfect will, Tim. And here's the devil's lie, guys, in the midst of it. And I was counseling the kid tonight. Devil is lying to you, dude. He is lying to you. Here's the devil's lie. So Paul, so Tim, so Levi, where's your God now? Where's your God now? And dudes, you know it. Those of you who have suffered some serious deals. You know, back October, Pastor Steve passes away. 2.5 months later, my dad passes away. Now, I didn't have this thought because I believed it was God's perfect will to take my dad home. Get him out of my hair, kind of. He's in heaven. But it's easy to, you can start piling these things up, and pretty soon you're like, you know what? And this kid I'm ministering to, it's like, this happens, and this happens, and this happens. And it's the Psalm 73 stuff. You guys need to read Psalm 73 when you start struggling with the fact that everything's going wrong in your life, and yet the neighbor next door, who's the drug addict, alcoholic, crazy man, whatever, he's got the party boat, he's got the house at the river, he's got the motor home, he's got the motorcycles, he's got the money, he's got, it's like, and you're living paycheck to paycheck. And you're serving Jesus, letting my light shine. When the enemy's lying to you, saying, just jump over the fence. Jump into the party in this backyard, man. Remember the good old days. It'll be that happy days kind of a deal. Lying. Lying. Devil's lying. Devil's mocking. See, where was God when all this happened? Where was God when Paul went to jail? No. Paul's telling Tim, I ain't moved. Acts 20:24, anybody know it? For none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry that I have received from the Lord Jesus Christ to testify to the gospel of God's grace. Paul wasn't moved. Tim, right here. I'm finishing, man. I'm home. I'm getting close. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness. Paul was like jazzed. He was excited, according to what he's written here. Tim, don't shame. Don't be shamed. Don't hide. Don't run from it. Embrace it. Embrace the suffering. Paul's duty in suffering. And lastly, verse 12, Paul's response to suffering. And I'm running out of time as usual. Verse 12, for this reason, I also suffer these things. So he's in jail, about ready to lose his head, because God appointed him a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher. Is that a fair deal, you think? Devil says no. The devil says, you've been taken, you've been duped. You're on the wrong horse, bro. You're in the wrong race. For this reason, I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. I'm not hiding it. I'm not trying to put it away or run away from it. For, and here's the key, brothers, I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. A verse you have to have tucked away in your heart. See, Paul's response was, I know him. Present tense. I know. Paul was convinced. persuaded, absolutely, absolutely. If he wasn't, what would he be telling Timothy? What would he be telling all the other Christians? Get me out of here, guys. Come on. Get money. Get troops. Get anybody. Get me out of jail. I'm going to die. I don't want to die. I don't want to die. I don't want to live was what? Christ. Die was gain. Man, I hope and pray that when the time comes, whew, more than likely be like, well, you know, two by, won't you go ahead? No, brother, you go ahead of me. You go ahead of me. After you. He knew, he was convinced. But also, though, Paul's advantage over everybody, which is the way it is. He had the advantage. Why? Because he had been there. Right? 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 4. You got to read it. You got to know it. Caught up into heaven. To what was the word? Starts with a P. Paradise. I got one ticket to paradise, you guys. Paradise. Paul had been there. Paul somehow popped his head up there. It's amazing. I wonder if he told anybody on the side, you know? Like, come here, I just got to tell you this, man. I got to tell you, man. I know I'm not supposed to, but you don't tell nobody, right? Hello? Oh, Bob has a new way of telling me that I'm done. No, it sounds like the little fire alarm deal. Whatever. Church is burning down, no sweat. We're almost done. We're almost done. Paul had been there. Heaven is for real. Tim, heaven's for real. I've been there. What an advantage. What an advantage that he had. But guys, we got to believe. We got to believe. We walk by faith, not by sight. And this is why I'm willing to suffer, is what he says. For this reason, I suffer. I also suffer these things. So in speaking to us, how you respond to your sufferings speaks volumes about what you believe, guys. Convinced he is real or not, convinced he is able, and your response is convincing or not to others as well. See, the only way you're going to make it through life's toughest experience, guys, is like I said, is to know that he's a real, that he's real, that he's alive. And that you know him and that it's personal. The application factor tonight, do you know him? Do you really know him? Is he real? Is he personal? Are you convinced? And I believe that's been settled in your hearts, but there has to be, and honestly, guys, the only way you really come to know that he really is real is when you are in the furnace of affliction. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Ebo Elder, as they were in the furnace, and who jumps in the furnace with them? They never would have seen that. They never would have experienced that. They never would have seen Jesus in the fire had they not been thrown in themselves. Do you know him? Do you believe that he is alive? See, that's the power in our faith. The resurrection. And if he's dead, as Paul said to the Corinthians, it's we might as well go right back to what we were doing if he's dead. If he's not alive, guys, and this is the whole thing about Christianity, the resurrection. You got to believe it. There's no options in this. But the only way you know it is to experience the resurrection power in your own life to make it through the most horrific and horrible life-changing worst experiences that come your way, or what we call life. I just described life. It's life. It's life in this fallen world, on this little insignificant speck in the scope and the scheme of the universe. When you look at it from that perspective, you realize, really? I'm given all this much time and effort to really nothing? Because we'll step out of that into eternity. What's the universe going to look like then? Who knows? Do you believe he's alive? Three are, unless you're convinced, so guys, you're going to be ashamed. You're going to run. You're going to hide. And we see martyrdom like never before in our lifetime. You know, we read about martyrdom. We read about Paul. We read about John the Baptist. Stories and this and that. We're seeing it, guys. We're seeing it on the news. We're hearing about it. I mean, the whole thing up there in Oregon. Really? Are you a Christian? I don't know if I'd have been saying yes after the first or second person. Amen? And yet, the reports and the accounts, and of course, the media is starting to already be watered down. Oh, no, it didn't happen that way. Even if it was the first person who said yes, and then the next one, wow, crazy. The people over there in Iraq and such, where ISIS is just flat, renounce Jesus and you will live. You don't. I mean, I don't know if you're following any of this stuff with Franklin Graham and this and that and what is happening over there and how they're, the torture. I heard the other day that they, a missionary over there, they crucified his 12-year-old son. Hung him on a cross. Wow. Unless you're convinced. And then, of course, lastly, the proof is in you, though. Holy Spirit, guys, is in us. As Paul said, I'm not going to read it because we're out of time, but Ephesians chapter 1, go back and read it, verse 7 through 14. You've been sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. That is the proof. That is the evidence. The changed life that you have experienced, that's the convincing proof that this is all real. Because, I mean, honestly, most of you guys, your lives, where were you going? Where were you headed? Did you change your life? God did it. God did the radical work. God did the miracle. Don't ever forget the miracle that was done in your own life as proof positive that he is real. Amen. Yeah, we stumble, we fall, we mess up. We're not perfect, but tell you what, you're in church on a Tuesday night. Hello. I mean, there's a hockey game on right about now. Years ago, what would you be doing? What would we be doing? Hockey, because I'm into hockey. Kings playing the Canucks. Where's my hockey fan? But oh, yeah, Dodgers. Are they playing tonight too?
Yeah.
Oh, no wonder some of the guys are gone. Man, no. Yeah, Dodgers, they'll do what they do every year. They'll be... I'm sorry. It's just, when you experience... How many times they've been there? Yeah. Wait a minute, you're going to catch the sixth inning quick. No, you still got to be here till 9 o'clock, brothers. Holy Spirit, the changes that have been made in your life, guys. You know what? Man, therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor me his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, guys. It is what it is, as they say. But I'm telling you what, looking back, man, there's no way I'd be where I am with Jesus today had I not experienced what I'd gone through. Don't wish that on anyone, but man, there's no easy way to get to know Jesus more and closer so that you can experience these things that you might in turn turn around and be used by God to further his kingdom even through the most horrible experience you could imagine. I'm telling you what, I would encourage you to get this book. This is a bestseller. It's changing people's lives even today. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the Apostle Paul, Lord, persuaded, convinced, knew that he knew, wrote it from a prison, days, weeks, months before he was going to lose his head. Father, thank you for the example, and pray, Lord, that as we continue to be crowded to Christ. As we go through these experiences in life, Lord, when they don't make any sense, Lord, help us to realize they make all the sense in the world. Thank you, Lord, that this is not our home. Thank you, Lord, that we are not citizens of this earth. We are citizens of heaven. And everything that is on this earth will perish, will be gone. And only what you bring to eternity, what we experience in eternity, is what's going to matter. Lord, help us to have that perspective. Bless the guys in their groups, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.